hi, good morning. Hey, it's April 4th today, and there's almost a foot of snow on the ground outside. Oh my gosh, what's going on? But it gives me another chance. I'm going to run my snowblower later this morning. Ooh, great thrill that is. Okay, so we're going to focus on the capacitors here, just around the output, the two output tubes, and I suppose the detector tube. So that'd be the entire audio section, and see if we can't get that working in this radio. Now, I do have a schematic here, but it's for a different version of this chassis. And what's so different is the output area, of course. So I really can't rely on this, but there's a number of capacitors shown here, right around the output tube, of course. So I'm just going to have to do this visually. It doesn't matter if I change a wrong capacitor. What does it matter? They're all on their way to being changed. Anyhow, so let's take a closer look at the situation here. In here. So, we get everything on camera? Yeah, I think so. You see one here, here, a couple coming into the detector tube here, all these actually. And this one's probably the tone. This is the tone control right here, so that's probably the tone capacitor. We're related to the tone control. Now, if I'm going to go after these two here, their terminals are buried way under in behind this control here. So I think I'm going to have to take this off and kind of pull it aside. Let's see, so it's got these wires here which are flexible enough. One of these is the actual lead wire going right into the transformer, so I don't want to bust this wire, but I don't think that's very likely. In some radios, these wires are so rock solid and stiff that if you move them, the insulation is just going to crack on them, and you're going to end up maybe setting up a short right in here, which you don't want to have happen. These wires are fairly short, but I think I can. It's got a gigantic shaft out here. I don't have to pull this thing all the way. I just got to pull it enough that I can get at that. Wow, I won't be able to move this very far. See, that's a wire. That's stiff. That one is. Oh, I just cracked it. You can hear the. Oh, look at that. So that's not so good an idea. Now, what about leaving everything in place, which is kind of what I'd rather do? I just don't see how I can connect down in there. Even if I leave the lead from the capacitor here, it's just so far down in there. Maybe that's the first thing to try. This one here. Oh, and then I've got the that resistor back under there. I should probably go after that too. Okay, it looks like I've got to move this. I have no choice. I don't have to disconnect it here. I can always disconnect these wires at their far end. I can disconnect it here. That's a good idea. That'll leave this capacitor right in place. This wire won't go anywhere on its own. Let me just nip it off back there. Okay, I think I know what I'm going to do. Should I just cut these off? Well, we'll give it a try with desoldering them first. There's not a lot of wire length here. If I start nipping away at it, I'm going to end up with another problem. If you look on this control, this lower one, the volume control, it has its usual three terminals down here, but it has another one out the back. This is a technique for sort of affecting the tone of the volume as you turn it up, because our ears, at a higher level of sound, our ears hear certain things better than the same things at a lower level of sound, and bass is like that. So when the volume goes low, we stop hearing the bass as well as we could. Or stop hearing the bass sounds first. So I think this is a technique for boosting the bass a little bit when you turn the volume down. Okay, let's see if we can get this off. Grabbing a resistor by the body. I can't see that anything is happening here. There we go. Can't get it off. At least I've made it into a cold joint here. Maybe I can cut the wire a little further up. Not so much luck. Okay, so much for that. Cut this one right in the middle. This wire's kind of shot now anyway, so I'm not going to worry about it. It's these ones I'm really worried about. There we go. I'll leave that green wire there till the last minute when I replace it. That way I'll know where it goes. Wow, isn't that an ugly scene there? Look at that thing. Now that's the bypass resistor, and it just looks... it looks horrible. But I got great access now to these terminals. Okay, so we'll nip away this first capacitor. Some lead wire there. Okay, what do we got? What do we got here? .005 is quite clear on it. Excellent. .005. Okay, that's... put in this guy here. Get my big screen going here in my shop. Get this guy to sit right down in here. And I'm working down here in the morning, and I'm very quiet today. Must be because the snow that's fallen is has depressed me. I guess that would be the way I should end that sentence. See, this would be my first spring at this location. I'm quite excited about it. I get out on my bicycle, go for walks in the parks. There's some beautiful parks here. See, these capacitors here have nice long leads on them. People ask me, where do you get your parts? And, you know, I'm not trying to promote anybody, but it's a fact. I buy these capacitors here, these nice ones here, from Just Radios, which is located about an hour away from here. And they sell just the right kind of capacitor, so you don't end up buying a bunch of these. Which I did. They aren't really quite right for using in a old radio. I mean, electronically they're fine. There's nothing wrong with them, but they don't look right in the back of a radio like this. If anybody cares to look. Okay, got one done. Woo! That's great. I wonder if we should test this thing right away. Do a couple more. Let's stick with the plan. We'll do this one. This one here. Okay, so it's going down to that terminal and this one here. Tucked in nice and close to two hot tubes and this hot resistor. I mean, what are the chances that these parts are going to last long? Long being 40 years. And what is it? Looks like another one. 0.005. Is that 0.005 or? Yeah, 0.005. I see it better on camera than I can with my own eyes. Another 0.005. Get the wire length here. Shrink tubing, or just any kind of tubing, really. Checking the focus here. Okay, let me just squeeze this down. I'm going to refocus the camera. good look at my lousy soldering techniques here. Soldering iron shuts off automatically after about, I think I have it set for 20 minutes. Which means every 20 minutes I have to turn it back on and heat it back up. Heats up very quick though. And that way I don't leave it on overnight, which has been the demise of many of my previous soldering irons. Just leave them on pretty high overnight. These two capacitors make all the difference. I don't really know. All the difference? No, I don't think so, because there's many other bad looking capacitors in here that you gotta guess are not helping this radio work. Now, will this be enough to bring the radio audio section back to life? Well, maybe, I don't know. I'm really not sure what I'm replacing here. This one here, I think, this connection right here, runs on this wire which goes out to the output transformer, pretty sure. It'd be helpful to me if I blasted this full of light, but then camera won't handle it. And as usual, biology wins out big time. Unfortunately, biology is not winning at the moment here. Be getting a better view again than me. Come on. Like I gotta chase the wire all around with these pliers here. If I had my magnifiers on, maybe I'd do this better. I'm really having a hard time seeing exactly what's going on. I missed entirely, didn't it? Okay, let me don the magnifier. Got it. Boy, you got a good view of that. I just looked up at my camera. Okay. Lights, magnification, line of sight, all this stuff. Makes a big difference. Okay, that's two capacitors replaced. How long did that take? I don't know, half an hour, 45 minutes, yikes. Now, let's put these guys to the test though. I'm really curious, these are the first two capacitors to come out, and I think it's well worth giving them the test. .005, a fairly small capacitor. I think we can get away with using these long leads on it still. Now, last time I used this machine, I got a little bit of a shock off it, which is on a video not yet posted for another radio. Actually have two radios, sets of video series not yet posted. I've been very busy here. And I got a shock from here. It's a little bit surprising to me again that it could happen. So let's just take a little voltage reading here. Just to see what I'm up against. It was a shock to, what did you see there? Just a couple volts. Good. I reversed the two-prong plug on it and eliminated the voltage. And it was, if you watch those videos, you know I got all wrung out about this guy because he has 145 volts on the case. And my capacitor checker, if I reverse the plug, has 165. Plug it into 120 volts and read 165 on the case. Still a mystery to me how that can happen, although I've had a fairly thorough theory proposed along with another person doing a bench test to demonstrate the effect that he is suggesting causes the higher voltage. And there could be some comments on some videos now that also have pretty good theories on how you get above line voltage in a situation like that. Okay, so a little far for you to see in the camera, but here's the eye. It's hard to see anyway, so I'll tell you what's going on with it. So we're going to do a leak test here. I think I can do something better with a camera. Hang on a second here. Let's just see if I can. Me for a minute. That's my capacitor checker. And the secret to getting this to look good on camera is to pour lots of light on the thing. I just don't think you can see the gap in here. This is like the trickiest thing I've got in the shop to get on camera properly. Worse is the camera has a mind of its own here. Well, you know what? You can see the gap. As lousy as that is, I'm going to leave it like that. You can see the gap now. Okay, so 25 volts. When I work the switch here, this eye is going to snap closed, okay, and then it's going to peel open at some rate. If it opens all the way like this fairly quick, good capacitor. If it stays closed, bad capacitor. Here we go. That's super quick. That's suggesting there's no leakage whatsoever. And it could also suggest I really don't have the capacitor connected here. Now my clip leads. So double check. Here we go. Oh, amazing. Okay, we're going right up to 250 volts here. I don't think it's connected. I don't think I got that. A lot of wax on these wires over here. I mean, would anybody believe that these capacitors are better than new? That test is showing that it's just as good as a brand new capacitor. In terms of leakage, anyway. Hard to believe, right? Let's try it again. Still at 250 volts. My gosh. Okay, another possibility is the capacitor is open inside. Let's read the capacitance on it. It's supposed to be 0.005. This is the scale. Now the way it works is the eye is closed, and as I go past the setting of the capacitance, the eye will pop open. Nothing whatsoever. Okay, meter's more sensitive now. You know what? I know why that leak test failed. Okay, let's repeat the leak test. I had this setting down here wrong. I had this set for electrolytic capacitors. So let's go back to the leak test. This will make a lot more sense now. Okay, 25 volts. Once again, if I hit the switch, this should close and then swing open. 25 volts, it doesn't open at all. Completely leaky. Now that makes a lot more sense. Okay. That's a lot more believable. So, just like any good researcher, as soon as you get the result you want, you write it down in your book and move on. You keep playing with things until you get what you want. Because, you know, you don't want your theory destroyed. That's the last thing you want. So, you just keep fiddling, and then that fluky reading comes that matches your expectations. You run with it. Well, I'm hooking up the other capacitor, by the way, in case you're wondering what I'm doing. Okay, the other capacitor is now connected. We're still on the 25 volts. Is it a leaker? It's a piece of junk. Can't even support 25 volts, so this is a real piece of junk. And no use trying to read the capacitance on it. It is shorted out by its own internal leakages. And my instrument won't work with a leaky capacitor. If you get a reading, it's bogus. Anyway, so there we go. Okay, I'm totally reassured that everything is just as I thought it should be. These capacitors look bad. The radio is working terribly bad. And it all adds up to those capacitors are bad, bad guys. Now, should we test the radio? It's a little tricky. I've got this out here. Could just clip lead it back. Give the radio a test. I'm really anxious to not mess this up. But I mean, hook up the leads wrong. Yeah, let's try testing it. This is going to be a little bit of a corny endeavor here. Clip that there. Clip it back to where it came from here. it. I'm already having trouble remembering where this came from. Huh. I have to end up watching my own video back again. Okay, that explains that. Without explaining myself, one goes there. Now, these long wires may very well introduce all kinds of hums and stuff in the radio. It's a fairly sensitive place for fiddling around with the volume control here. But that should do it. Okay, who wants to wager on this? Is this gonna fix it? Well, I give this one a rating of fat chance. Fat chance this is gonna fix it. Okay, volume's down. This is the tone control, switch is on. Just leave it roughly in the middle. Maybe it's not even that critical to hook this stuff up. In fact, okay, it depends how they've done the tone control in this radio. First two capacitors, did we hit the mark? I think we're ready to start. Dim bulbs are coming on the normal way. We're on the broadcast band. Oh! Hey! Well, we get a buzz. Volume control is now voluming. Okay, now how about... Well, okay. So that's enough to bring back the audio section of the radio back to life. Now let's just see what's happened with the power rating here. 51 watts. It was 55, wasn't it? Now it's 51. And if we take a look at that resistor there. 28. 22. So 28's not much hotter. Yeah, that's the most I can get there. 25. 29. Still going to get pretty warm. Okay, I'm watching my watt meter down here. I'm going to put full power on it. 62, 85. My line voltage meter just took a dive. 84 watts. Okay, let's switch it off here. My line voltage meter went from, I thought it was up here. I just kind of got out of the corner of my eye, dropping 10 volts suddenly. But anyway, hey, we've had some good success here. The audio section has come back to life. We found the two capacitors I removed are terrible, just terrible. And so, yes, you're all going, I told you so. Well, I knew that too as soon as I looked in the radio, that these capacitors are bound to be horrible. I just kind of want to learn what I can as I go. So I'm trying to approach this in a way that teaches me stuff and fills the numerous gaps in my knowledge. So, great. Now, those two actually connect to, which pin is it? Two capacitors I changed. Connect to pin 1, 2, 3. Pin number 3. On a 6F6. Pin 3 on a 6F6. Pin 3 is the plate. So, and where do they go? They go to... go around to the cathode. That's what it looks like. You know, this doesn't make sense as a cathode resistor. Because of what's it connected between? That resistor is on pin number 8 down here, but up here it's pin number... I can't see it. It's blocking the... it's definitely not pin number 8 on the other two. That's weird. It's pin number 2. Pin number 2. Connecting 8 to 2. Well, what would that be for? 8 is a cathode. 2 is a heater. I don't know. I don't know. I'm not going to follow that. Well, I'm thinking I probably got something wrong there anyway. And now I'm analyzing it. I'll just carry on. You know, this has to be Yeah, you know what they've done? I think they're using this as a... this is a ground terminal here. The other side of the resistor is connected to the tube terminal on one of the two tubes. And there's a wire back to the cathode on the other tube. And also another wire back to the capacitor. It all makes sense. There's no question. That's the cathode resistor shared by the two output tubes. Okay, well, we'll just carry on. We'll work our way back now into the detector circuit. I'm not going to worry about this tone one yet. I'm not going to put this control back yet. Although now it's kind of in the way in a different way. Maybe I will stick it back like this. Just get it kind of out of the way. No, it's not really out of the way. It's just more in the way. This guy, they'll be next. Step by step, we'll bring it back to life.